God bless you, my friend and sister Sharon. And today we are discussing how to know if you love this present world. I'm going to give you six areas to look at, but let's go right into the scripture so that we could have a template, a portrait of what to look for in our lives that we can prepare ourselves to get ready to position our hearts for repentance. Repentance means I'm about to turn and go the other way. Why? Because however we are living that doesn't glorify Jesus Christ, it doesn't glorify God the Father, we got to get rid of it. So let's take a look and see six areas that you can look at to know if in fact you are in love with this present world. The Bible tells us very clear, beloved, in 1 John chapter 2. Listen to what John wrote. He said, "Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life." Beloved, these three areas must be constantly combed over. We got to look at it in our lives. The pride of life is where I want to focus today. The lust of the flesh, we hear about that all the time. We all know sex outside of marriage, fornication, masturbation, any type of sexual perversion, homosexuality, lesbianism, bestiology, any sex outside of a marriage covenant is sin. Point blank, you will not go to heaven if you're practicing a lifestyle. If you are doing this, you won't go to heaven. So that's the lust of the flesh. The lust of the eyes is materialism. The lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, that means that you have an appetite that's unsatiable, a lust for the things of this world, houses, cars, land. But I want us to take a look at the pride of life, because the pride of life, beloved, is where many of us are being deceived. And the pride of life is an area in which we boast, in which we are proud of it. And this will move us away from Jesus. This will move us away from the vine. And we will, if we are practicing the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, or the one that we're going to focus in this quick exhortation, the pride of life, you will know it, beloved, because you do not have peace. Because when you are basking in the pride of your life, which is rooted in idolatry, the pride of life, if we lay that axe to the root is idolatry. Let's look at number one, education. Education has become a god, a false god worship of intellectualism that has taken over many people that believe in Jesus, but they're not following Jesus. And one area that we see education as the pride of many people's lives that I've been declaring on the channel is in the churches, where everybody's a doctor, a bishop, an elder, a prophet. Everybody has a title. But let us know and understand, beloved, that Jesus, he told us in the book of Matthew that he didn't want us to call anyone our father or our teacher. Teacher meaning master. He said, "You are all children of God." So he canceled out that we should not be calling each other anything but brother and sister. It doesn't matter what your office, quote, your function, whether you're apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, or a teacher, it doesn't matter. We are brothers and sisters in Christ. So when the pride of your life is on you, you exalt yourself through your intellectual pursuits. And this is where many people insist that you call them by these titles. You will see this in your life, beloved. People who have gone to college and got their degrees, you go to their websites. This is just something to look at. You go to their website, and it might be your website, and all you see is all this about you, not about the kingdom. It's about you. It's about all of your accomplishments. It's about everything you've acquired, all of your college degrees, all of your, you know, when you was in first grade, you won a blue ribbon for that. When you hit the sixth grade, you got it. You know, it's you're just all plaqued up. You know, you got plaques all over your website, your Facebook page. We see your trophy room. And listen, beloved, one of the traps and snares of education is once a person gets these degrees, they literally worship them. They put them up in their offices and at home as a shrine. This is a manifestation, beloved, of the pride of your life. Another area of the pride of life is beauty. When you are a naturally beautiful person and you are spending all your time on, you know, Snapchat, I don't even use it. I don't know the name of it, but Snapchat, every 5 minutes you taking selfies, we go to your Facebook page, it's just splattered. Every day you got a new photo of you. It's just your life story of all these pictorials. Beloved, you are manifesting what you love. It's idolatry. Now remember, what we love, we talk about it. We exalt it. We go through great lengths to showcase what we love. So when we showcase our beauty, you'll see it. You'll see this with people. You go to their house, they got pictures everywhere. They got pictures from 1970, 1960, when they was young and they was a size 5. Now they a size 20. And they got these pictures of themselves, big ones, 16 by 20s, 18 by 24s, all over their house. Why? Because the pride of their lives is their past life, beautiful and thin and trim. And they still worship, follow me. It's a form of self-worship. That's why that shrine is all through their houses of them. And you're like, man, this is, talk about a throwback. I mean, this is all through the house. So that could be a manifestation, friend, that you are basking in the pride of life. And it is your beauty that you're exalting. Another area to watch for the pride of life is ministry. When we are lifting ourselves up, as I already said, as Dr. Bishop, that's pride. It's spiritual pride. And we got to remember, beloved, that pride comes in many hues. It's different shades of pride. It will manifest itself in you. And this is what I want you to keep in mind as I continue this exhortation. You will know that you're blocking and that you are off because you don't have God's peace. If you're tormented constantly in your mind, if you are definitely dealing with loneliness and you just feel barren and everything is dark and doom and gloom, somewhere, beloved, you may have a door open in the pride of life. And also, I want to go back to beauty. I say it a lot, but many of us, we're in love with our own booty. We're in love with it. We're in love with our breasts, hips, thighs, and that booty. And this is all you spend your time fixing it up, prepping it up. You spend all your money on it because that is the pride of your life. And so when you hear someone like myself to keep warning the women what the Spirit is saying to us, we got to put our clothes on, ladies, and stop all this half-nakedness. You're not going to make it in because it's a manifestation of what's really going on in your heart. How you dress, how you adorn yourself speaks volumes. It tells us a lot about what's really in here. Number 4 is your children. Some people, their pride is their children. They exalt their children. They worship their children. And the only time that they find peace is when they're asleep. Now, these are adult children who you still worship every beck and every call, every time they call you, every time they on the phone. I mean, you jump through all types of hoops. You're most of the time angry. Your whole life is your children. It's the pride of your life is those children. That's all you talk about. When you meet strangers, you whip out that photograph, you know, you got a whole stack of pictures. And this is all you think about. Yeah, and you will brag, you will boast about how they got accepted at the Ivy League college. You know, they got a scholarship and this and that. And you're constantly boasting and bragging on your children. It's the pride of life, beloved. And we have to put that stuff away. We have to put a check so that we know that we are walking in the straight and narrow path. Because there's no room for the pride of life when we're talking about all of our accomplishments, our children's. And this last one, this is going to be number 5, is accomplishments that you are utilizing trophies. Beloved, when we are exalting trophies and you have a lot of Christians or confessing Christians who have been deceived and they are taking all of these different carved images that are being regarded as awards, it's the pride of life. Because once they fashion that graven image, they usually, you know, I'm not going to call no names, but a lot of the gospel artists are partaking in the pride of their own lives. And they will literally worship the statue or the carved image. They literally worship it. They showcase it. They'll have a whole room dedicated to the pride of their lives. And some of us, we may not be celebrities and be where people know our name, but when we come to your house, we see a whole room set aside for your, when you was in the first grade, you got a trophy. When you was in the sixth grade, you got one. High school, you got one. All through college, you got all these trophies, graven images. They've been carved out. They're graven images. It is idolatry. Idolatry, beloved. And you need to take all that stuff and throw it out, because what it does, it keeps you away from following Jesus and giving up everything. Listen, beloved, people don't want to believe, but Jesus requires that we give up everything. Everything means in here. That means whatever it takes so that you become his disciple, that your life becomes disciplined. To listen to him, to say the things that he tells us to say, to do the things he tells us to do, which oftentimes is going to bring enemies, but you are willing to empty out. But if you keep basking in the pride of your life, you keep talking about how you got to get this college degree and how I didn't spend all this money. And I got all these student loans. I got to finish. But if God never told you to go there, beloved, and now this becomes your boast that I have a BA, I have a BS in this, I got a PhD in this. Oh, beloved, it's a trap. It's the pride of life. I want to encourage everyone as I close this exhortation to please go and study 1 John chapter 2. It is a very compelling, it's a serious chapter, because it's letting us know there are things that clearly tell us that we're still in love with ourselves and this present world. This is why we partake. And I'll give you an example of the pride of life really quick that'll help you. When I began to write books under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit back in 2005, my first book that I published, the publishing house wanted me to give them a bio and a picture. And I said, no, I don't want to do that. I just wrote the book. I'm not the author, because I know that the Holy Ghost is the one that gives me inspiration to write. So I don't consider myself an author. I'm just a writer. I write what I hear. I mix it with my personality, of course. I mean, God uses vessels, but the primary thought in my writings have come from him. So I told this owner of this publishing house, I don't want to do that. Well, that's how we do it. That's how everyone does it. No, thank you. I don't want my picture or a bio. It's not necessary. So what she wanted was the pride of my life. What are you proud of? Give us your accomplishments. Tell us the highlights of your life. My beloved brother and sister, that is the world. That is not how this kingdom operates. We do as best we can to walk in humility. Amen. No, we don't have to go with the flow. We go against the grain. And she argued with me for a while. She kept on insisting. No, let's stick to what the book is about. Let's stick to the backside of the book telling you what's in the book. You'll need to know all that. You'll be able to discern, because you don't want the person that wrote the book. You want the knowledge or whatever they have to impart. You're not necessarily, when you read a book, got to know all these details. That's what the world does. It totally tries to dictate how we should do what we should do. But we are not of this world. Amen. God bless you, my friend. I hope those six things give you something to comb over and look at in your life, that we walk worthy of our confession of Jesus Christ, and that when he comes, when the bridegroom comes, we will be without spot or wrinkle. We will be pure, clean, and holy, set apart for the Master. God bless you. Till next time, my friend.